Welcome back to Rara's Ventures. I hope you're well. Today we are visiting the British Wildlife Centre to share with you what to expect whilst visiting. If you have only just joined and would like to help support what we are doing, please hit that subscribe button. It's free and it will really help support what we're doing. And don't forget to hit the notification bell so that you don't miss any more upcoming videos. So today, the reason I keep laughing is because we have my little cousin with us, Bella, who will be featuring some of our videos, and she's making me giggle lots already, so I just thought I'd give you a heads up. She will be here with us, helping us share the interactions that they have for children and wanted to join us on one of our visits. Before we begin, I thought I would share a little of their story of the Wildlife Centre, which I have quoted from their website, so that I give you the right information. So, a little bit about their history. The British Wildlife Centre was funded in 1997 by David Mills on the site of what is now the Wildlife Centre. For 30 years, David was a dairy farmer with the award-winning Venn herd of pedigree Jersey cows, which in its day was one of the leading Jersey herds of the country. In 1994, David ceased dairy farming and reluctantly sold his beloved herd to create his own zoo. He decided to specialise in British wildlife as he felt that there was a need to educate the public about native species and about the challenges they face living in the wild in Britain today. The centre finally opened for free book tours in 1998, with David doing everything himself, looking after the animals and giving guided tours with a friend helping out with the admin. The centre opened fully to the public in 2000 and has been growing slowly but steadily ever since, with over 20 staff now employed. Inspirations. David's inspirations for the centre were his heroes, pioneering conservationists Sir Peter Scott, Gerald Durrell and John Aspinall, who had starred their own wildlife centres. John Aspinall actively encouraged his keepers to form close bonds with the animals and provide a stimulating environment to encourage natural behaviour, a policy we wholeheartedly embrace here at the centre. Conservationists through education, we are sometimes asked why we do not open every day. The reason is on weekdays in term time we specialise in school visits and other exclusive visits. We can then focus on teaching children to appreciate and respect Britain's own wildlife, native wild species, so that they may develop a lifelong interest in their protection and survival. Our physiology can be summed up as conservation through education. We are a privately owned organisation and the vast majority of our profits are plunged back into improving accommodation for the animals, breeding programs, conservation, and providing the best experience we can for our visitors. Our aim is to remain a non-commercial specialist visitors attraction that provides a unique insight into the world of Britain's wonderful wildlife. Okay, so we are now going to go in and have a little explore with little Bella and see what we can find. Okay, so we are now at the aviary where there are owls, where all the owls live. There is a selection of owls in here. There are little owls, barn owls, tawny owls, which we've got one right behind us, long-eared owls, and the eagle owl. So I thought I would share a little information on the little owl. The little owl is the most commonly seen owl in Britain, but it's actually a very recent arrival, having been introduced into southern England by the Victorians. They are now found throughout the lowland England and Wales. It is Britain's smallest resident owl and easily identified by its compact shape and staring yellow eyes. Favourite habitat is farmland, and it is often seen at dusk or even on the daytime sitting on a post or telegraph pole. Little owls hunt from perches such as these, pouncing on small mammals, birds and insects, particularly earthworms and beetles. Their call is a whistling sound, not unlike a lapwing or a meowing cat. In flight, they can be seen usually low to the ground, following a gentle undulating path. So I just want to share a little bit about the owls. Bella's very much enjoying herself and taking lots of pictures, bless her. Now we're going to carry on and see what else we can find. We are at the Wetland Boardwalk. And we're having a good little walk round. Are you enjoying your visit, Bella?
Yeah.
Have we found lots of animals so far?
Yeah.
Yeah, cool. We have come across the Wetland Boardwalk, with over 600 metres of boardwalk takes you into their 26-acre wetland nature reserve, with a wonderful views and a huge variety of wild species making it their home, including a group of resident nesting herons. Also, we started with the mobility scooter, but unfortunately the scooter kind of broke down on us. That's our fault. But it is accessible in most parts. The red squirrel enclosure, we wouldn't have been able to fit the scooter through there. I do believe you could fit a wheelchair in there though. Comfortably, and once you're in there it's all easy access. So we're going to carry on and see what else we find. We are now by the foxes. The fox is a remarkable, adaptable and successful animal found where food is plentiful in almost every habitat. It is an excess because it is willing to eat almost anything and has become particularly adapted at surviving alongside man in farmland and urban areas. With its bushy tail, large ears and narrow muzzle, a fox unmistakable. The coat colour can be extremely variable, unusually reddish brown on top with lighter upsides, but much darker or even silvery forms are not uncommon. Mating season is December to February, where the vixen can be heard at night uttering its eerie high-pitched scream. Four or five cubs are born in the spring and the female fox stays with them in the earth for 2 weeks, fed by the dog fox. They remain with their mother until autumn, when they disperse to find territories and mates of their own. The life expectancy of the fox is short, 12 to 18 months in urban areas. 58% are killed on the road, and rarely beyond 3 years in rural areas. And we've got a beautiful one just behind us. So we're at the deer park, and there are two kinds of deer, this side and on the other side, which we'll be sharing with you. We have the roe deer, and we're going to share a little about the deer, which are behind me in the rural suite, aren't they, Bella?
Yeah.
Yes. So we're going to share a little bit about deer. The red deer are Britain's largest native land mammal, and together with the roe deer are our only native deer species. All other deer species have been introduced in all deer species except the reindeer. Only the male has antlers. Antlers are shed each spring, and immediately a new set start to grow, taking 16 weeks to reach full size in August. They are made of a type of dense and very solid bone, and whilst growing are covered with hairy skin called velvet, which is shed when the antlers have reached their full size for that year. The stag uses his antlers to fight other males during the mating season, known as the rut, which lasts for 3 weeks in October. You can see past year's antlers from our stag in the reception area, which we will take pictures of course, and show you, and we'll share with you a bit later in the film. So, yeah, we love these deers, don't we?
Yeah.
They're beautiful, aren't they?
Yeah.
Yeah, we're really enjoying our visit. So we're going to carry on and see what else we can find, can't we? Yeah, let's go. So we are at the Otterservation, Otter Holt, so we've got to keep our voices down because they're in the background
fast asleep. They're so sweet.
The otter is a large member of the weasel family with an amphibious lifestyle. In the day, they are exclusive, secretive animals living in undisturbed rivers and streams. In the early 1960s, they were on the verge of extinction due to river pollution, habitat loss, and hunting. Now, with full legal protection, cleaner rivers, and managed habitat, it is returning to former haunts. Through its distribution, it will always be limited by the availability of fish. The male otter is called a dog, and the female a bitch. They have large lungs and can stay underwater for 4 minutes, often swimming 400 meters before resurfacing. They can reach speeds of 12 kilometers underwater and can outrun man on land. The male occupies large ranges, which may include up to 20 kilometers of bank riverbank, and daily travel long distance along regular routes by the margins of the river. So there's a little bit about the beautiful otters, and you probably have Bella running around in the background. She's really enjoying herself, as you can probably hear. She's looking at all the animals. Okay, we're gonna carry on. Let's go. We are now at the Nocturnal House, this unique enclosed housing, rarely seen native night species, was opened by Chris Packham in March in 2012, featuring specially designed reserve lighting for the Nocturnal House. Allows you to observe the mysteries, nighttime world of bats, hedgehogs, and dormouse during the
day.
Now, obviously, we're going to go around there and we're going to try and film some, but because of the lighting, we're not sure how much we'll be able to pick up. So, fingers crossed, let's go see what we can see. We are at the Badgers now. I'm going to share some information about the Badgers that I've quoted from the website. All the information that I'm sharing with you, I have quoted from the website, just to let you know. So the badger is the largest member of the musk-tailed family and Britain's largest land carnivore. They're nocturnal, emerging at dusk in summer to spend the night foraging. In winter, they are much less active, but do not hibernate. They live in social groups of 4 to 12 adults, and when not active, they line up in an extensive system of underground tunnels and nesting chambers, known as a set. The female is called so, and the male is called the boar. Badgers are now protected by a number of laws. The Protection of Badgers Act 1992 consolidated past legislations which had made badger baiting and digging illegal, and in addition made it an offence to damage, destroy or obstruct their sets. This protection has enabled the UK badger population to dramatically increase to the point where it is said to equal that of the red fox. The issue of the badger's role of bovine tubular colossus to cattle is very controversial. There are other factors apart from badgers which need to be studied before a final conclusion can be reached. So we're going to go in and go and see what we can find, see if there's any badgers we can say hello to. So we have stopped at the Buzzard area, and right, we have Bella with us today, and their buzzard is called Bella. How cool is that? So we thought that was quite fun. But anywho, we can't see the buzzard. They said she's probably down the back there, so we thought we'd point the camera like this and maybe we'll get to see her. Buzzard is the UK's most common large bird of prey, found mainly in the western half of the country, but now increasing their range into the south. They live in all types of habitats, from open farmland to uplands with wooded valleys, frequently seen soaring in groups high in the sky on hot air thermals, while emitting the distinctive meowing cry that you can actually hear in the background. They have keen eyesight, 8 times better than humans. They usually hunt from low perches such as gateposts and fences, feeding mainly on small mammals and other animals. They are sometimes mobbed by gulls and crows, who see them as a competitor for their food. Okay, so we shall carry on. So I just wanted to share some information about the visitor centre. I'm not doing it inside because it's quite busy. This is normally the start of your journey, which houses the admissions desk, the British Wildlife gift shop and their coffee shop, offering drinks, cakes, snacks and hot and cold lunches. And we did stop here for lunch and it was very yummy, and we did have a quick cup of coffee. We have come to the end of day. Have you had a good day, Bella?
Yes.
Cool. So we have had an amazing day. Okay, so I think Bella enjoyed her day as well. We found that it is quite accessible. There are some interactions, isn't there, Bella? Some things you can play with at the park and different things to read about.
Yeah.
people. The car park is free and has 5 disabled parking bays. They have 1 wheelchair that you can borrow if you feel this is something you need. I will call before your visit to ask them to put it aside for you, as this is a first come first serve basis. Also, because of the nature of this place, they do not allow dogs, including guide dogs, so please bear this in mind before booking. I will be leaving all the links down below so that you are able to find out all the information before your visit. I would like to say a big thank you to the British Wildlife Centre for letting us visit today so that we are able to share with others what to expect before visiting. We have had such a lovely day. I would also like to say a big thank you to Hubby for doing the filming today, and also a big thank you to Bella for joining us and helping us to share what interactions they have here from a child's point of view. So thank you, Bella. I hope you've enjoyed your visit today.
Yes.
And I would also like to say a big thank you to all of you watching and supporting the channel. Don't forget to hit the subscribe button and the notification button and a thumbs up. So that really helps support the channel. We look forward to seeing you again very, very soon. Take care and lots of love. Bye.
Bye.